Good morning, everyone. It is great to see all of you here this morning. Give you a very warm welcome. If you're visiting or new, you are especially welcome. Hope you feel at home with us. One of those folks is Stephen Kearns, who's one of the students for the ministry from our presbytery and working now in our presbytery as he continues his studies working in White House. So, Stephen, delighted to have you with us this morning. I look forward to you sharing with us. Can I thank everyone, as always, who are involved in so many ways, not least this morning, the decorations of the church and everyone who does everything to help us in our worship. And can I encourage everyone to stay for refreshments after the service down in the coffee bar. It'd be great to speak and share with you. Do we have any celebrations this week? If you've been in and not too busy speaking and watching the screen and the announcements, you'll have seen a picture there of Janice McCalmont, and we want to congratulate her on her recent marriage to Savelino Vasco in Africa. So that's news for you, and we'll maybe get that picture up at the end if you didn't get to see it. Okay. Any other birthdays or celebrations this week? Okay, we're going to turn to Psalm 24, words that we often turn to at this time of year as we celebrate harvest. So we're going to use them as our opportunity to call ourselves to worship, to come and to focus on God together. So the words are going to come on the screen. I'm going to say verse 1, and then you join with me in verse 2, and so on like that. So let's hear and read God's word together. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not sin idle or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates, be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates, lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Let the King of glory, the Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. Let's stand together as we come to worship God, as we sing, we plough the fields and scatter.
Oh,
Let's continue in worship as we pray. Let's all pray. So, Father God, as we gather together in this place today, as we lift up our voices in singing, as we hear and read your word together, we pray that all of these things might enable us to turn our attention away from ourselves and direct it towards you. Lord, that we would see you as we are, as you are, as the one who is God alone, as the one who is the creator, the one who made all things, the one who sits enthroned, as it were, above the circle of the earth. You're the one who created all the beauty and wonder and variety of this world, and show us in that something of your power and of your glory. You are the sustainer. You're the one who holds all things together in your hands. Day follows night and continues on, and season after season through the year, because of all that you have put in place and because of all that you are and all that you do. The earth brings forth its produce because you're the one who sends the sun and the rain, and you're the one who gives life and growth. You're the one who is the provider. And so we come in thankfulness and in worship and in praise. We come humbly this morning, acknowledging the things that we so often take for granted, and giving you thanks in all things and for everything that you give to us. As we've sung, our life, our health, our food, the ordinary things of life day by day. And we give you thanks too, Lord, for the greatest gift that you have given to us, the gift of your Son, Jesus, coming into this world, demonstrating your love, dying on the cross, rising to new life, and for those who will come and put their faith and trust in him and find forgiveness, you give gift upon gift, blessing upon blessing. And so, Lord, we thank you for your grace, your ordinary grace and your saving grace, for your goodness and your provision in every way. Receive our thanks today. Receive our praise. Be lifted up in our worship and come among us by your Spirit, for we pray it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. It is wonderful to be with you here this morning. Boys and girls, I have something in my bag here that will teach us everything that we need to know about harvest. Let me see if I can just get it out here. Do you know what that is? We have here Heinz Big Soup Chunky Vegetable. Now, do you want to see if you can name some of the vegetables that are in this can of soup? We can open it up to everybody, yeah? Sorry? Corn? There is, let me just check the ingredients. Yes, we have sweet corn here. Good job. But there's more than just sweet corn. This is big soup, big chunky vegetable soup. What other vegetables do you think there are in it? Leek? It's a sweet leek? I'm not sure. No. No, definitely not. Okay. Well, no, there's no leeks, unfortunately. Maybe potato and leeks would be more your thing. Yes? Tomatoes. Do you know what there is? There's tomato puree in this. So that'll count. Good job. Any other ones? Carrots? There absolutely is carrots. What's vegetable soup without carrots? Uh-huh. Any more? Any other takers? Potatoes, celery, there is definitely potatoes in here. Celery, no, I'm not saying celery. Again, not a swede, is it? No. There's swede in here. I still don't really know what that is. It's like, oh, a turnip. Well, why don't I just say that? Okay, we have, so the top vegetable in here is carrot. So good job. And then we have potatoes, peas, onions. red peppers, 2% Swede, sweet corn, water, concentrated tomato puree, lima beans, corn flour, and rapeseed oil, and wheat, and then a whole lot of other wee bits and pieces like your salts and your peppers and iron and things like that there. Loads and loads of vegetables in our soup. And that tells us that months ago, a farmer had to plant seeds of all those different types of vegetables, plant them in his field, water them, look after them, tend to them, and then sometime later, he had to come along and pull them out, harvest them, or probably in his truck and tractor, drive along and gather all the vegetables for soup. And then it was sent off to the soup factory. Then also, we have water. Water, if without the water in the soup, it would just be lumpy and dry and no good at all. And the water was sent to the soup factory as well. And there were full of people in that factory, chefs and cooks and people who came up with the recipe, who decided which ingredients they wanted, which vegetables they needed, and they came together and used their intelligence and their wisdom in creating a recipe to make not just ordinary soup, but chunky vegetable big soup. And this is all the things that we have together to give thanks for, the vegetables, the provision of water that we enjoy, even the drink and wash and things in, and the people who use their wisdom to create the recipes for soup. But there's more that this can of big soup tells us about harvest. Because if I take the label off here, you'll see, I'm going to completely destroy it. Let's see. This can of soup is made out of, what do you think that's made out of? Tin. We've got a tin of soup. And tin or steel is made from iron. And tin's not made from iron, sure it's not. It's. I'm getting an education this morning as well. But it is harvested out of the ground. No one planted anything to make tin or iron or steel, but it was the rocks and in the minerals beneath the earth. And so human beings had to devise the tools that they needed to be able to dig deep, to pull the metals out of the earth, to refine them down, and then to use their science and technology to make it into something that we can use to store our big chunky vegetable soup in. And so we're thankful for the metals that are in the earth. Then we've got this. What do you think this is made out of? Paper. Paper, of course, comes from trees. And so trees were planted and grown, and then they were cut down, and then they were sent to the sawmill, and they were pulped down, and then created into paper. And we have so many uses for paper, from the labels of our soup to writing in school, to reading books, for tissues, for everything. We use paper, and so we have much to give thanks to God for, that we have paper. But this is not how the paper comes off the trees, is it? It doesn't come off green. In fact, it's not just green. If you look carefully, there is a lovely photograph of the soup, and you can see the peas and the swedes and the potatoes on the spoon. All these different colors had to be injected into the paper in inks, and the colors themselves weren't created in the factory by the people. These colors, in fact, come from nature itself. If you look out, even at the minute you walk down a street and you'll see trees, their leaves just a couple of weeks ago were lovely and green. Now they've turned from green to yellows to reds to browns. And we see all of these colors in nature. If you've seen during the week there, I think it was Wednesday, there's a really heavy downpour. And I saw this huge, big, massive, vibrant rainbow in the sky afterwards down by the valley. And it was huge. And you could see the whole arc of the rainbow and all the colors that were in it. Color. The colors that we enjoy to see and look at and create things that are beautiful were created by God. And so we give thanks to God for the contents of what's inside the soup, the vegetables, the water. We give thanks to God for the metals that we have from the earth to create the container for the soup. We give thanks to God for the paper that we have to label the soup and the colors that we see on the front of the soup. But that's not all. There's more we can give thanks to God for, because if you look at the back of the can of soup, you will see ingredients of all the vegetables that are inside the can. You will see instructions on how to microwave this can of soup or cook it properly. We have language and writing and give thanks to God for our abilities to communicate with each other, to tell each other things whenever we can't speak to each other but have to write it down, that we have books that tell us all sorts of things in school and we can read and we have able to write letters to each other or even on the computer, and we have the Bible and other books as well that we're able to read in our own language. We have so much to give thanks to God for: our writing, the inks, the paper, the steel, the contents of the soup can. We have so much to give thanks to God for. Does anybody know what this thing is? See these here? This looks like a zebra. Yeah? You know what that is? Do you know what it's for? Whenever you go to the shop, and you're in the shop, and if you're at the self-checkout, and you want to do it all by yourself because you're completely independent, you go up and you scan this at the end, and it goes beep. That's right. It goes beep. And that tells a computer in the machine right in front of you at the checkout to tell another computer in the stock room away at the back that one can of soup has been sold, and to take one off the number of cans of soup that they have, and if it was the very last can of soup that they had in the shop, that they need to order more. It's amazing the technology that is involved in just wee straight lines of black on white that tells the computer so much more information than we can even imagine. We can give thanks to God for the technology that we enjoy, that you're able to hear me through the microphone, that we have lights and heat, and we have technology even in our shops for buying food. We have so much to give thanks to God for. But that's not all we can give thanks to God for. There is so much more than just the potatoes and sweet corn and Swedes and carrots that are inside this can of steel that was harvested from the earth, that was wrapped in paper and covered in inks with writing and technology printed on it for us to use. But later on, whenever I get home, I will be able to pull the ring on top of this, fill it up into a bowl, and heat it up and enjoy it. And as I take my bowl of soup later on, and I take it after it's been cooked, I will feel it in the bowl, lovely and warm, ready to eat. As I'm carrying it over to the table, this soup that's in my bowl that's been heated will probably fill my nose. I'll be able to smell it as I'm carrying it over. And before I've even had a chance to try it, I have so much to be thankful for God for. The heat and feelings that we enjoy, the smells that we have, our senses, that I can see all those different bits and pieces of vegetable in my bowl, that I will be able to taste it. And in fact, I think maybe everything other than hearing is involved when we eat soup. We can see it, we can feel it, we can smell it. Maybe it's gone really badly if you can hear it, if it's starting to boil over or burn. But we have so much to give thanks to God for. He gave us our bodies and our senses that we can feel. And then, as we've already talked about this morning, and as Al's mentioned in his prayer, we can give thanks to God for Jesus. Because not only did God give us creation and the fruit and vegetables that we enjoy to eat, and the metals in the earth to be able to make the containers for that, and trees for paper and inks and technology and writing and our senses, but he gave his own son. Because he loves us. God is the source of life. He is the one who created all of life, and he gives us new life by sending his son Jesus to die for us, so that by his death, he gives us life. We have much to give thanks for of Jesus this morning. As we come at harvest and we look around and we see all the representations of what God's good creation and world looks like, we can remember we have not just a good world to give thanks for, but a good God to give thanks to. Even with a simple can of soup, we have so much that we can give thanks to God for. Let me pray, and then I think we're going to sing, and then boys and girls can go out to the children's church. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you that you are the God who made heaven and earth. We thank you that you've made everything, and your word tells us at the very beginning that it was good. It was very good whenever you made everything. That you gave us plants and to eat. You gave us your world to use and to make soup cans from. You give us our senses and our bodies. We thank you that you love us so much. That even though we are sinful, even though we have messed up, you love us. And we know this to be true because you sent your son Jesus. That while we were still sinners, Jesus came and died for us, that by his death we might have life. We thank you that you are the good God who loves us. We pray you bless the boys and girls as they go out now and the rest of this day, as they think about things that they can be thankful for. We pray that we would all be thankful to you for who you are, the God who made us, who loves us, who sent his Son for us and draws us to himself, giving us new life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We are going to sing now, I've forgotten what this, for the fruits of his creation. So we're going to stand together and sing, and then the boys and girls can head out.
Okay, folks, at this point, can I just mention a few things to you? A reminder, we heard last week a little bit about Tear Fund and their work, and we support that at Harvest, and so there is a noticeable bucket on the way out for retiring offering for Tear Fund. And then we'd love to see many of you back here this evening. We'll have another Harvest service, so a time for a little bit more singing and thoughts and an informal time together in worship this evening. I'll be speaking then, so I hope to see many of you back at 6:30 tonight. If you are just here or visiting, please do take one of our general leaflets. You might want to take one of these monthly leaflets for October to tell you all the things that are happening. And also we have now these flyers, which are for our daytime activities that are happening at the moment. So Wednesdays, coffee and chat, tots on Thursdays, and lunch on Friday. So take one of those to remind yourself to give to someone else, to invite them along, whatever. I know that none of us will ever take a bowl of soup again in the same light and without much thought and without looking for Swedes. But when you get a tin of soup at home, I want you to be thinking, do you know what? I don't need a tin. I can go to Abbey and I can get freshly prepared on the premises soup by our wonderful chefs, and I can chat to folks and I can bring other people and welcome them into the church building maybe for the first time. So something for you to think about. This week is our prayer gathering as well on Wednesday evening at 8 in formal time. If you haven't come before, an opportunity to begin. You folks have come recently. You don't need to pray out loud. You can just be part of that. We have a short reading and thought and a time where things are suggested and time to pray. That's 8 to a little after 9 on Wednesday. And then this is the month of special services. So next week is our BB enrollment. We look forward to seeing many of you here. And old son of Abbey and Abbey BB, Matthew Nicol, will be coming and being part of that service next week as well. So we look forward to that. Let's again join together in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we have been reminded of the breadth of the many things that we can give you thanks for today, we want to do that, but we also want to recognize that we need to come in confession, Lord, to acknowledge our greed, our selfishness, our materialism, our lack of concern for other people. Lord, we are part of a world that is like that in so many ways, and which then collectively impacts in so many things, in so many people. Lord, in a world where there is enough, so many go without. Lord, help us to consider our own lives and lifestyles and choices. Help us in our attitudes towards others. We pray today for the many different agencies and groups that seek to be a practical help to people. We think locally about the food bank in Newton Abbey. We thank you for that and for our partnership. And we pray that that work would continue to develop, to be a help to people, not just in providing food a few times, but in supporting them in the challenges of their lives and helping them get the support that they need. And most of all, in them knowing that all of these things are done because of your love and our love for them. Lord, we pray for the work of Tear Fund that we support today, as we've been hearing about that last week, that there would be a growing of hope, that, Lord, that there would be a help for people to learn new skills and new ways to be able to provide for themselves and to be sustainable. And that would bring a difference to homes and families and communities in different parts of our world. So take and use our offering to that end, Lord. Lord, we pray for all that goes on in our world that causes so much difficulty. We think of the war in Ukraine, which at the first seemed a little bit away from us, and yet has impacted food supply and so on in our world in so many ways. So we pray that you would bring resolution in situations like that. Lord, we pray for all those who provide for us, for all those who produce food, for all those who work in agriculture and the food industry, who, like in so many industries just now, with so many different factors, go through difficult times. Enable them, strengthen them, help them in their work and in all that they do. Father, at this time of harvest, make us thankful. Lord, make us humble. Lord, make us prayerful. Lord, we can't come today, but also want to respond to the things that we've been seeing on our news screens this week, near and far. We think of that terrible atrocity in Thailand. We can't imagine the grief of almost every child and staff member in a nursery being killed. We pray for your peace and your help there, and in the many different situations, many of which we do not hear about. And Lord, we think of the folks just up the road in Donegal and Creestock, in a small community which has been so impacted by this awful accident. We pray for all those who are grieving, for a community in shock, and for all those who have been impacted, even those who have been helping and working through these last days. Come and bring your peace, your love, your help. Point people to you in the midst of difficult times, we pray. Lord, we take a moment to bring our own prayers to you as well, for we come with the things that trouble us. We come with our concerns for ourselves and others, and it's to you that we turn and bring our prayers. Hear us, we pray, for we ask all these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Okay, as Stephen comes to prepare to read and to share with us and lead us through to the end of our service, we're going to stand to sing a more modern song that we learned a little while ago, My Worth Is Not in What I Own.
Is not in what I own, not in the strength of flesh and bone, but in the costly wounds of love at the cross. My worth is not in skill or name, in win or lose, in pride or shame, but in the blood of Christ that flowed at the cross. I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure, wellspring of my soul. I will trust in him no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone. As summer flies, we fade and die. Fame, youth, and beauty. Trust in you.
Well, let's turn in God's Word. If you have a Bible, please turn to the book of Philippians in the New Testament. Philippians, the very end of that Paul's letter, Philippians chapter 4. And we'll be reading from verses 10 through to 23, the end of the book. Philippians chapter 4, this is God's Word. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Yet it was kind of you to share my trouble. And you, Philippians, yourselves know that in the beginning of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church entered into partnership with me in giving and receiving except only you. Even in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs once and again. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that increases to your credit. I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gift you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice, acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The brothers who are with me greet you. All the saints greet you, especially those of Caesar's household. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. And we know this to be true. Let's bow in prayer together for a moment. Our God, as we come to your word, we pray that you would grant us open ears and soft hearts by your spirit, that we would hear the gospel of your son Jesus. Amen. Have you ever received or maybe written a thank you card recently? We were at a wedding over the summer of friends of ours who'd gotten married, and we received from them recently a thank you card for celebrating their wedding with them and for the wedding gift that they'd received. If you've ever sent or if you've ever received a gift voucher from Amazon and you go to activate it, Amazon now for you prompts you to send a wee thank you. If someone has an Amazon account and has bought you an Amazon gift voucher, all you have to do is click the button and it will send on your behalf a thank you email so you can express your gratitude for the gift voucher. You don't even have to go and think about who it was or how to get in touch with them or what their email address is. You just click that button as soon as you've activated your £20 gift voucher, and a wee email shoots off to them saying thank you very much. And of course they know how sincere and genuine and heartfelt that message was. At the close of Paul's letter here to the Philippians, he is addressing the inciting incident that caused him to write this whole letter in the first place. He had received a gift from this church, from this Christ community in Philippi. They had sent Paul a gift that sent them a care package for his time in prison. And so this whole letter, in one sense, is a thank you note from Paul that he sends back to Philippi. And Paul writes with sincere thanks and deep appreciation to the Philippians for their act of kindness, and he expresses how glad he is to receive the gift. He's so glad of the gift, yet not because his supplies were running low and he really needed a new toothbrush and a new pair of pajamas. He rejoices because of what this gift actually says to Paul, what it means. It's not just primarily about what has been given, but rather about the givers, his brothers and sisters in Christ, the Philippians. So verses 9 or verses 10 to 19 tell a tale then of generous giving. Those who have lovingly and serving with a servant heart express to each other a way that glorifies God. They are charitable. They are happy to have what they have and happy to help. But in the middle of this thank you note from Paul in these verses, Paul tells them that he knows how to be content no matter what he has, or even if he has not. In years of plenty and when years of less, he wants the Philippians to know the secret of surviving. So this morning we're going to have a look and a listen in on the secret that Paul talks about and what it means to be charitable and content. Happy to have and help, but also happy to have not. The secret of contentment and the good news of Jesus, the gospel that this is unchanging in all of life's circumstances, the ups and the downs. If you read Philippians chapter 4, verses 10 through to the end, as we've just done, but you skip over the second half of verse 11 through to 13, you wouldn't realize that anything was actually missing. Listen, I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, yet it was good of you to share my troubles, etc., etc. Reads as if there wasn't anything missing at all. Paul commends the church community for sending the gift. He's clear, though, that the reason he rejoiced greatly in the Lord, that familiar phrase that repeats throughout all of this letter, is not because of what he has been given, but rather that the Philippians have given. He says, you renewed your concern for me. The gift that Paul received was a token. It represented the love that the Philippians had for him. And it was a reminder to Paul that the church had not forgotten him. In many ways, the gift could have been absolutely anything. It was not about the monetary value. It was not about Paul's momentary need. It was what the meaning of the gift communicates, their love. In verses 17 and 18, Paul explicitly states the reason why he rejoices greatly in the Lord over this gift. He says, not that I desire your gifts. What I desire is that more be credited to your account. I have received full payment and I have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received the gift you have sent. They are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. When we give as Christians to the work of ministry and gospel, it's more than simply giving. It is a fruit and it is a fragrance. Let me explain. In one sense, it's the fruit of righteousness that Paul mentions here, the fruit or the evidence that you are abounding in God's love. It's an expression of God's love at work in you, but also a way of showing God's love. God's people are called to love one another. We are called to be known as people who love one another and to be known by our love. We show God's love by giving because, as we said with the children, God gave. He loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that those who believe in his Son will not perish like perishable foods, but will receive life eternal with no expiry date. God, who is rich in mercy, who loved us and gave himself for us, is seen in our lives as we freely give ourselves. And when we give, we are acting then in faith. We are acting in faith that God will provide. The act of giving is an act of faith. We don't need to hoard. We don't need to amass wealth ourselves. We don't need to cling tightly to things. We can, in humility, value others more above ourselves. We can afford to not look to our own interests, but rather to the interests of others. We can have the same mindset as Jesus. What good news. As well as being a fruit of righteousness, Paul says that it's also a fragrant offering. Verse 18, I've received the gift you sent. You are a fragrant offering and an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. When we give, we're not just giving, and it's not just an act of faith, but it is also an act of worship. It is giving that is pleasing to God. And so no wonder Paul greatly rejoices in the Lord over receiving this gift from the Philippians, because it shows him where they're at in their life of faith. Our giving says a lot more about our loving. And the Philippians were, as Paul prayed at the start of Philippians, abounding in love. Jesus said, "For where our treasure is, our hearts will be also." The Philippians have been transformed by the life-giving grace of God, and they were showing it. They were responding to God's love by giving to Paul, and he was so pleased. He was so pleased because by seeing this treasure, he could see their hearts. And yet, as grateful as Paul was for this gift, Paul takes time to explain in the middle of it that he has learned to be content with life with or without the gift. He's not being ungrateful here, but right in the middle of the second half of verse 11, Paul interrupts his thinking on the gift with a quick note about how he's more grateful for the giver than he is for the gift. He says, "I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances." I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. Paul was in prison. And to the Greek philosophers of Paul's day, this was a bad place to be. I think for us today, we would say a first century Roman prison is a pretty bad place to be. But Paul was content. He would be content whatever situation he was in, because he had learned the secret of being content. For the Greek philosophers, being content was akin to being self-sufficient, completely independent with no external help at all. What would it take for you to feel content? But Paul's secret to contentment was very different from the cultural contentment of the world around him. One church leader long ago said that you have made us for yourself, O Lord, and that our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. Contentment can only be found in the Lord. The old rockers Mick Jagger and Keith Richards sang something similar whenever they lamented, "I can't get no satisfaction." Because whether they recognize it or not, outside of the Lord, true contentment is a hard thing to grasp. And I think we're prone, well, I am, to seeking contentment the same way that the Greek philosophers and the Rolling Stones, where we chase peace, contentment, and satisfaction in the good life. We rely on job stability, financial gains, our health, mobility. And yet, don't we know that these things are so easily knocked, so fragile at times? These things are not big enough to hold our contentment. And when they're gone, when we don't have them, we certainly are not content in the difficult days of want and need and hunger. So what does Paul say in verse 12? He says, "I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or living in plenty or in want." Paul says this from prison, and not for the first time in prison. He had learned to be content, and he beckons us in to hear the secret. He says, "I can do all things through him who gives me strength." Sometimes this verse is seen as the kind of go-get-em verse. You can do it. Go on, climb that mountain. Reach for the stars. Yeah. But in reality, it's a much bigger verse than simply inspiring you to do something. It's a much better verse than that, because it's the secret to Paul's contentment. Let's break this famous verse in half. I can do all things. Paul isn't being hypothetical here. He isn't some aspirational motivator with positive thinking. He's not saying, "I can do anything and everything that I dream of." He is saying, as we see from the previous verses, "I can do anything that comes my way, the ups and the downs, the hilltops and the valleys, hungry and well-fed. I can do all of these things. Not just the things I want to do, like coming first in my class or getting that job promotion or having that house. It's all the things, even the things that don't pan out the way I would intend." And maybe And especially in these days, we feel that we're coming to the end of our rope at times. I can't do this. I don't know what this winter will bring. What if there's another lockdown? How will I heat my house? And Paul reminds us, in the comfort of life, and especially in the difficulties of life, you can do all things. And you would rightly ask, well, how? So let's turn to the second half of this verse. Through him who gives me strength. This is a pretty well-known verse, and it's a great verse, but it's Paul's secret verse for learning how to live in contentment. But it's also a verse, I think, that for me, that I knew too well. I was maybe over-familiar with it. I mean, I think I got the gist of it in my head. It was one of these memory verses that you learn in Sunday school. And I know it's about Christ strengthening me. And I think I learned it as I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But the NIV and the ESV, which I read from this morning, translates it as him. And rightly so, because in the Greek it is a pronoun. And I don't say that just to show off how well I've been doing in my Greek classes at college, because that would not be accurate at all. And don't get me wrong, this certainly is about Christ here who does the strengthening. But if we read the paragraph as a whole and start in verse 10 as we read this morning, we see how Paul refers to Jesus in this passage. He talks about, I greatly rejoiced in the Lord. And so I think when Paul says through him, he wants us to think of Jesus in categories of Jesus is the Lord. This is how Paul addresses or refers to Jesus throughout the letter. In chapter 2, verse 11 of Philippians, he says, every tongue will confess and every knee will bow that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. At the end of this very letter, in verse 23, he calls on him the Lord Jesus Christ. And to this Greek-speaking church in Philippi, their Old Testaments would be like ours, in that in the Old Testament, anytime they came across the name of God, it would say, Lord, like in small caps. And so what Paul is saying here is that Jesus, who is the Christ, is the Lord. He is God. So what is Paul's secret of contentment? I can do all things through the Lord who gives me strength. And maybe Paul had passages in mind when he was writing this, like Isaiah chapter 40, that says, do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary. His understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary. Young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is our God. And if you work your way back through Isaiah chapter 40, we get pictures of how big God is, this great big God who holds us in his hands. His hands are so big that measureless waters are in the hollow of it, that he's spread his hands over the breadth of the heavens. And yet, at the very beginning of this chapter, we get an intimate picture of the Lord, the God who tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 11, carries them close to his heart. And he gently leads those that have young. And what do we discover about the Lord who gives strength here is that he's a shepherd. That this God who is so big that he can span all of the heavens in his hand and all of the waters in the hollow of his hand is intimate enough to be able to draw his sheep close to his heart. And that should trigger for us Psalms like Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. And isn't that what Paul is suggesting here? Is the secret to contentment in every situation. And no wonder he can rejoice in prison then. He tells the Philippians, I'm not saying this because I am in need. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. What comfort and what contentment this can bring to know that the Lord Jesus Christ, he who has the name that is above every other name, gives you strength for every situation. This is what Paul exclaims. I want to know more. I want to know Christ. Knowing the Lord, knowing our good shepherd, knowing our Jesus as Lord means that I will not want. I have no needs. The learning of the secret of the contentment in every situation helps us face every situation of life. So when we face difficult days where we cannot cope, We need to remind ourselves, the Lord gives you strength. When we are tempted and feel the pull of sin to forgo holiness and to walk away from God, remember, it's the Lord who gives you strength. And when we are prone in days of plenty to be self-reliant and content with the material possessions that we have, and life is easy, we must remember then also that is the Lord, not ourselves, who gives us strength. Depend on the Lord alone, because this is the secret of contentment. The reason we can live so charitably in giving others and not hoarding, because we trust in the Lord who gives us strength. Those who belong to the Lord, our gracious Savior. Hear the words of Isaiah 40 once again as we close. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And my God, Paul says, will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Our God, we recognize that so often we are prone to entrusting in ourselves alone, that we desire to be independent, self-reliant people. Lord, we pray that by your Spirit, you would prod our hearts to recognize that we can do all things and face all days through the Lord Jesus Christ, who gives us strength. In his name we pray. Amen. As we close our time of worship, we're going to stand together and sing, Great is thy faithfulness.
Oh, God, my Father.
I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.